First, I want to start with a book that looks insanely intriguing. It's called Who Will Speak for America? And Nathaniel Popkin is one of the authors. He wrote it and put it together with Stephanie Feldman as well. And Who Will Speak for America, and you can see it there, the website, whowillspeakforamerica.com, deals with surviving the Trump epoch, this world that Trump has taken over. But from the standpoint of artists and writers, it's a perspective that we may not have considered before, because we oftentimes talk about political resistance and political movements in the face of this Trump wave. But seldom do we get a chance to talk to artists and writers who also have to exist in this time that's very, very different than times past. So welcome, Nathaniel Popkin, to Rebel Headquarters.
Hey, Mark, how are you?
I'm well, and so glad that you're here. So in a nutshell, tell us what the perspective is of a writer and an artist in this Trump world that we're in.
Well, by nature, writers and artists are incredibly sensitive people. So right there, you start with a real need to feel what's going on, interpret it, observe it, and then react to it. But the other thing I would say is that writers, of course, have this capacity, writers particularly. And our book includes poets, fiction writers, essayists, polemicists, even comics. We possess the capacity, I think, as writers, as Grace Lee Boggs said, to stir the soul. And that's what's happening here. This book takes you from the moment of the election into some very personal reflections, through to coming to terms with the America that already was and was deeply imperfect, and out to what might be on the other side. And I should say the title, Who Will Speak for America, comes from a speech given by Barbara Jordan, Congresswoman Barbara Jordan. She was the first black woman to speak in front of the Democratic National Convention. She gave the speech in 1976 on the heels of Watergate and Vietnam. And she posed that question in a similar time for a slightly different reason, I think.
Yeah, I'm glad you mentioned Barbara Jordan in that speech, because you could look at that time and see that we were coming out of Vietnam, out of Watergate, into a time of greater awareness or greater sort of political consciousness and public consciousness. But this has been a period during which we have backslid, many would say, into the worst of America. And I think so that stands in contrast and opposition to that time which we thought we were moving into.
You got it exactly, Mark. So Barbara, I mean, if you consider her journey, it's extraordinary. And if you consider how fragmented and pulled apart America was in the post-Vietnam era, and yet there was a much stronger sense of unity than there is today. And so when she posed that question, who will speak for America, what she was really referring to is who will speak up for American ideals? Who will unify the country around those ideals? Stephanie and I decided to put this book together, and we posed the question of who will speak to America, and we asked 40 plus writers to respond to it. And when they responded to that question in their writing, they thought of it a little bit differently. They thought about it as, who's going to be allowed to speak for America? You know, right now, the person who is claiming and his allies who are claiming to speak for this country are nationalists and nativists and white supremacists in many, many cases. And so the writers in our book who come from a wide, incredibly wide range of backgrounds of all different kinds interpret that question much differently. And they want to fill that void of who will be allowed, who's going to take the mantle and speak for what America is, has been, might be.
Yeah, it's interesting because in a way, the increase in the profile of, as you suggest, white nationalists and others who claim American identity in a way that we've never heard it sort of claimed by such a broad group with such great political power has perhaps discouraged many of us from our effort to stake claim to a country that has compassion, that it has empathy, that has, in a sense, a view of the rest of the world that includes us, a sort of connectivity, you know? But what you're doing, and if I understand correctly, in this compilation of all of these different artists, writers, poets, is they're saying, no. We stake a claim to this country. We still represent a great power in this country.
I'm reminded, even today I was reminded of how much it feels like being bullied by what we're going through, you know? And this book attempts to sort of, the way you deal with a bully is that you get as many people on your side as you can to be around you to face up to that bully. And this book is not a book of unified voices necessarily, but there is a unifying sense of diversity, of tolerance, of compassion, of connectivity, as you say. And these are values that are in stark contrast to those of the present regime. What you have in this book, I think there are maybe 5 or 6 or 7 folks who are direct immigrants, refugees, asylum seekers, and the like, people who have an experience that is so powerful and that is being condensed into villainhood right now by the president at the border, you know, people being called vermin. And these are the people who bring with them to this country the deepest amount of really reflection on what it is they're doing and why. These are the people we want. These are the people we want to celebrate.
And I suppose what it means to be an American, you know, the based on the backgrounds of the people that you've just described, right? I mean, these are people who all bring a different personal history to this country.
Yes, and it's an open question. What does it mean to be American? And again, we have a present regime that wants to define it in a certain way. And the 40 writers, and so there we have comics, so there's some really funny stuff here. There's some people who simply observe what happened right after the election, or one writer who observed 3 days during just a random time to see how screwed up this is. But the line that runs through the book as the pieces shift from speaking for ourselves, speaking to America, is the last part of the book is speaking for America. That is embodying the voice of the America that we want to have. And that's a really polymorphous voice.
Yeah, and it's funny though. I mean, it's worth remarking on. It's not funny, that all the proceeds go to the Southern Poverty Law Center. Clearly, you feel a connection to the civil rights that have been are more than just a little bit infringed upon by this regime.
We do. I mean, there's so many issues at question here right now. From obviously the environment, the massive deregulation, global warming, and the lies that are being told about that, which is probably the greatest thing that's happening in terms of a threat. But really, what we felt so virulently, so tactily, in the last few months, is this assault on our civil rights, on the rights of American citizens and American non-citizens who happen to find themselves here. And so, yes, a lot of it comes down to this question of constitutional rights, this question of citizenship, this question of declaring what it means to be American. And you're talking about a substantial number of immigrants who are coming from places where they already considered themselves American. They're from North America or Central America or South America, so many of them. And so there's this funny question about this label that we use to mean from the United States as American. Some of our writers really want to broaden that definition in an interesting way that would be very valuable to all of us.
You know, it's interesting, the artists, I think, in this world, and clearly reflected in your book, occupy such an important part of this conversation, because journalists, we get caught up in the 24-hour news cycles. We get caught up in what to cover. We cover a tweet from a president that distracts us from open corruption that's going on in an administration, and an administration that's also, as you say, destroying sensitive habitats and selling out the country's interest to big corporate powers. And you jail a journalist, or you jail a couple of journalists, and all of a sudden you'll have a chilling effect on those journalists' ability to report things. And people don't realize we're not far from just that which I've described. But artists, and this is why I'm so excited to have had you on the show today, artists seem to occupy a slightly different place and perhaps a more powerful place.
Well, maybe at the end of the day, there's a little bit of power in the freedom. And so, of course, writers can stir the soul. Writers can, so a lot of this work came out of Writers Resist, which was a nationwide event that took place on January 15, 2017. One of the things that, one of the passages that we read at Writers Resist in Philadelphia was Pier Paolo Pasolini's poem, The Resistance and Its Light. And it begins, and now we walk into the resistance. And so there's something really powerful about that poem, which was written in the mid-20th century, that we can embody it. We can take that voice to be ours. We can use it to motivate others. And I'll say one more thing. One of our contributors is a man named Ganzir. He came as an asylee from Egypt. The reason he was able to declare asylum in the United States is because he was the victim of political suppression in Egypt right after the Arab Spring. So his work was seen as subversive, and he was arrested. So, and he's here with his incredible art and his incredible writing to speak for a whole different situation of people who are feeling suppressed. We'll see if it goes so far in this country where it gets so powerful that what we're doing, that they seek to repress us. So far, we're off the radar.
Yeah, oddly, he may have just arrived in time for a resistance that's quite significant here in this country. The book, again, is available now. It's called Who Will Speak for America? And you can get it through the website speakforamericabook.com/events. speakforamericabook.com/events. Or you can just Google Who Will Speak for America book, and I'm sure it'll take you there. But Nathaniel Popkin, congratulations. And again, all the proceeds are going to benefit the Southern Poverty Law Center. What an effort. It's intriguing. It's breakthrough, and it's clearly pointed in the right direction. So thank you for joining us today.
Thank you so much, Mark.